bring them out, bring them out, bring them out, bring them out. It's hard to yell when the bat rails in your mouth. Come on. Bring them out, bring them out, hey. Bring them out, bring them out, hey. Bring them out, bring them out, hey. Bring them out, bring them out, hey.
Welcome to Atlanta Startup Village number 69. Give yourselves a round of applause. We are almost at 70. It has almost been 7 years of Startup Villages. So you guys are in the right place. We are the largest monthly meetup of entrepreneurs in the Southeast. So you are in good company tonight. Oh, I like it. Everybody got real quiet. Okay, great. Good job. I'm Allie Merritt. I am your MC for tonight. If after this event you want to talk to me about pitching, I will be up front. Okay, I got some housekeeping. So, first of all, we have an eternal sponsor. You're sitting in the fantastic space of ATV. They have always been our sponsor of space, and they very kindly also do all the logistics, the setup. They help with the beer. They do all the things. So, can I please get a warm welcome for Julie from ATV?
Hey, guys. Welcome. We're so excited y'all are here. Raise your hand if you are not currently a member of Atlanta Tech Village. Keep your hand up if you are an entrepreneur. Keep your hand up if you are the entrepreneur of a technology startup. Awesome. If you have your hand up, I am talking to you. So, Atlanta Tech Village is the fourth largest technology startup hub in the nation. We currently house a little over 300 technology startups working on awesome proprietary technology. And if you are not currently in this building calling ATV your home, you should be. And if you would like to, we are here solely to help you guys succeed. And if success sounds attractive to you, then come find me at the back, the sound booth in the back. I will be there to talk to you and tell you how you can get in these doors. Sound good? Thank you. Oh, I don't know if I said my name. Julie Pierre, the community manager here at Atlanta Tech Village.
Thank you, Julie. All right, so who here, we're gonna do this two different ways tonight. Usually I say who here has a beer and everybody gets excited, but we have two different things tonight. So let's start with the beer. Who here has a beer and is excited about good beer? Yes, all right. One of our fantastic sponsors and has been a frequent sponsor in the past. We hope that they keep staying a sponsor. Because of all of the fantastic other things in this city with technology, they are here to sponsor. So come talk to us about ATDC. Let's give them a round of applause, guys.
So hi, everybody. My name is Ben Andrews. I am the statewide program manager for ATDC. Who here has heard of ATDC? All right, a lot of hands. So we are the state's technology business incubator. So we work with technology startups from the very, very early idea concept phase all the way up through finding their product market fit, figuring out their scalable model, and then scaling up to over $1 million in revenue. Once a company hits 2 years in a row of over $1 million in recurring revenue, they graduate our program. We graduate about 5 companies a year. We track our graduates for 5 years after that, and over 90% of them are either still in business or have had a successful exit. Last year, about 75% of the companies in Georgia that raised some type of money from an angel investors or VCs were ATDC members or graduates. ATDC companies are awesome. You do not have to be at ATDC to be an ATDC company. We are a program, not just a space. We have a number of fantastic companies here at Atlanta Tech Village, and we love every one of them. And we do a number of events that are open to anybody. Anybody in the state can join our Educate program. It's only $25 investment. You get access to meeting our coaches, meeting our sponsors, coming to our classes. And another upcoming event that you do not have to be a member to apply for is in November. We are going to take a number of companies, probably about a dozen, up to a roadshow in Boston and New York to meet with VC firms there. The last time we were in New York, we had VC firms walking out of the room, calling other people in their office, being like, you need to get here right now, and coming back in, and people just coming in throughout the whole time. So we're going to have about 40, 45 firms in the room. So if you want to raise money and you're looking for that, you need to try to apply for a roadshow trip, and you can do that on our website, atdc.org. Thanks, everybody.
Nice job, Ben. Okay, so who here has a Coke product instead of a beer? Oh, guys, there's it. All right, there's some hands. I frequently have it requested that we have more than just beer. So I want you to give a warm round of applause in just a second. Hang on.
to our Coca-Cola representative, and I also want to say you should stick around after. I know I usually do all the drawings like in between the pitches. They are giving away a pair of some pretty nice tickets. I'll let him talk to you about this, but it will be at the end. Must be present to win. It will be a raffle. So, can we get a round of applause for Coca-Cola, please?
All right. Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Matt Garner, and I'm a sales manager with Coca-Cola Bottling Company United. Coke United is a private bottler. We're based out of Birmingham, Alabama. And 2 years ago, the Coke Company gave us an awesome opportunity to be the producer and distributor of all Coke product here in Atlanta. So my team is responsible for all of our local relationships with restaurants, hotels, sports and music venues, and office spaces just like Atlanta Tech Village. So we provide equipment, product, service for our vending machines, cooler equipment, and then of course the fun and innovative Coca-Cola Freestyle machine. So please come by and see us tonight. We want to be a part of you guys as you grow. We want to grow with your companies. We want to handle all of your beverage needs, and there's no better way to satisfy your employees than with an ice cold Coca-Cola. So we hope that we can help. Oh, and the swag. So we got a swag bag tonight, and then anybody heard of 311? Yeah? Yeah? So stick around. We're going to raffle off some 311 tickets tonight, too.
All right. Thank you very much. Oh, that was a really sad clap. We're going to do that again. Thank you very much. This is the power of the microphone. All right, I got a little more housekeeping. Bear with me, and then we're going to start rapid fire going through all of it. First of all, this is live streamed tonight. It will be recorded. We have an eternal live stream sponsor who does it out of the goodness of their hearts. PoleSpark, thank you very much. We appreciate you. You know how I feel about clapping by now. Okay, so you're all sitting in chairs. You all have name tags. You have gotten, hopefully everybody's gotten a raffle ticket. That is due to our fantastic volunteers. And what they get in return for doing this hard work and taking the chairs down after is they get 30 seconds up here to pitch. If I could get all my volunteers to come up here and line up, please. Come on. We're going to go through all of y'all's 30-second pitches, one after the other. If you are interested in doing a volunteer, that's all you have to do. Show up. Get people to put on name tags, take down chairs, that's it. And in return, you get 30 seconds in front of you amazing people. So, if we could get one round of applause for our volunteers, and we're going to go through all of them. Here we go, guys.
So, I'm Daniel Konjerski. I'm with Stormy Nights Interactive. I do game development, and that's what my company focuses on. So, it's game development mixed with education. We're actually looking for funding through clientele. So we're software consulting and game development. So if you're looking for anything sort of similar in that range, then definitely stop by and talk to me.
Good evening, everyone. I am Camille. I'm a social worker, and I'm here to represent post-care health. In the hospital, of course, it can take us anywhere from 2 hours to sometimes 2 days or 2 weeks to discharge a patient for finding placement. So my online portal, of course, what we do is we streamline the discharge process for hospitals. The longer a patient stays in the hospital, the more it costs the hospital. The quicker we can get them out, the quicker the hospital, of course, can make their return. Post-care health, we help in that we allow the discharge planner and the social worker to be able to go to the online portal and find the placement for the patient so they can place them quicker. Do you have a need for seed? And of course, too, a need for network as well, too. So get in contact with me. My information is in the back, and I'll be here to the end. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Brianna Franklin. I'm the founder and creator of the English Major Takes Tech. Our motto is innovation through communication, and we offer content and communications development services to small to mid-sized tech companies, and recently have pivoted our interest to focus on clients in the health, wellness, and fitness space. So for all your writing and content needs, come see me.
Howdy, I'm Aiden Pratt, lead instigator of EPACA. We're here to put a dent in the fundamental beliefs of online shopping. Of the fundamental beliefs of the internet by reinventing online shopping. Because starting out as a new seller can be quite tedious and frustrating with little time or expertise. It also can be kind of difficult to get higher in the search ranking and actually grow an audience that loves you and your product. At UPECA, sellers of any size instantly get seen and loved while having more time to focus on making their products great. So I'm asking if anyone you know or you yourself or is an online seller. If so, please contact me. My information is in the back. You'd make my day 10 times over.
Thank you very much for our volunteers. We appreciate y'all. All right, who is ready to get to the main event of the evening? Yes. Are we ready to go?
Guys, we got a lot of open seats over here. If you have an open seat next to you, please raise your hand. Go make a friend.
No pressure.
You guys are awesome.
Like a little bit of pressure, but no pressure.
We want you to be comfortable.
Yes.
All right.
Okay.
We're ready.
Here we go. Give a warm welcome to our very first presenter of the night, Sports ID.
Good evening. Good evening, everybody. Yes, I'm that Ryan McNeil. Went to the University of Miami. We won 2 national titles, 2-time All-American, played in the NFL, 2-time Pro Bowler, 2-time All-Pro, University of Miami Sports Hall of Fame. Yeah, that's me. But I'm not going to talk to y'all about that tonight. I'm talking to y'all about Sports ID. Some key company facts. Sports ID is an Atlanta-based technology company providing web and mobile solutions to navigate the sports ecosystem. The sports ecosystem is huge, it's large, and it's successful in spite of itself. And so we're building solutions and tools to make it easy to navigate. The big vision. Our vision is to build the most efficient, simple, easy-to-use data and analytic network-driven network in sports. Our team, that tall, dark, handsome guy to the left, that's me, the rest of my team, Ray Farmer, former NFL general manager, Tory Durden, Harvard MBA, Dr. James Perkins, PhD, Keenan Echols, award-winning UX, UI designer, and Earl Camp, our business development guru. The problem is big. Fragmented market, services, resources, and information, the results in lost opportunity, loss of time, loss of exposure, and loss of talent. Why are we doing this? The main product I'm going to talk to you tonight about is Camp ID, our product we currently have in beta. The simple question we've been asking in the sports community is there a quick and easy website, mobile app for parents to find, review, select sports camps for their children? And as a camper, is there a tool that can help me get better as an athlete? The answer is a resounding yes. The solution is Camp ID. Camp ID is a digital service that connects athletes, parents, and coaches to sports camps, and so much more. You can search our solution by sport, age, sex, cost, location, skill level. We have 5, beginner, novice, intermediate, advanced, and elite. In the future, we'll have camp ratings. You have a camp profile for camps. You can see all the information on the camps on our solution. Camp organizer back end. This is where we think it's going to kind of change the game. You have the camps, they can manage their registrations, manage their staff, post news, social media, track attendance, and more importantly, capture stats. One of the things that is a big problem in sports, especially youth sports, is verified data and validated data, and so we aim to change that. A camper profile, have the camp history, you can track their awards, their stats, and track their comments and evaluations, and most importantly, it syncs through API to Sports ID, our main data information hub. The market is a $3 billion market as of 2015. Increases about 2 to 5% annually, and 35 million kids participating in sports right now. Timeline, as you can see, we started this a while ago. Any tech entrepreneur in here knows it's not easy. And so we're looking to launch our beta, a 1.0 version, in August. Technology, this is our stack, AWS, we're serverless, we got API gateways, Lambda Core, DynamoDB is our database. Cognito, we have infinite scalability. So when I commissioned our backend architect to build it, we wanted to go from 1 to 1 million overnight if we had to. Competitive landscape, there are others in the space, but they focus on verticals or they're focusing on one particular area of the space, which is registrations or team management. We have the connectivity to do everything. Traction. We're testing in Atlanta now. We'll do South Florida next. That's where I'm from. We're connected. I mean, we have a general manager of the NFL team as part of your team, you know, we're pretty connected. There's nobody we can't get to in high school, college, or pro. We put a little money in it. We applied for Sports Radar, Sports Technology Accelerator. We got accepted. And literally just recently, we got accepted into, we got offered, and we accepted a spot in a national Atlanta-based technology accelerator. We'll be there in the fall of this year. Go back for a second. We got about 500,000 data points in our database. We have about 25,000 plus camps in our database. Our business model is simple, two-sided marketplace, software as a service model. These are our financials. And we think we're pretty conservative, but in year three, we'll be kicking butt. That's it. And I have one video to show me. Oh, time's up, so we got about 14 seconds. So I'll save the video for later and do a live demo that I'll send to Allie that she can show everybody. Thank you.
So who here has ever seen me wave this sign and ask people to repeat the question? Yeah. So we're doing something new. Instead of making Ryan have to repeat the question, we have this toss mic. It's soft. It's a little terrifying. You know that, right?
I'll toss it. I'll be nice.
So if you have a question, raise your hand. Whoever has the catch mic previously, whoever has it at the end of time, please send it back up to the front. We did this last month. It worked out well. We only hit the TV once. It was fine. Who has questions for Ryan?
So let's do questions fast so we can get a lot of them in. First question right here. It's going to be easy. That was too easy.
Are these camps going to be geared more towards travel ball AAU competitive placement camps or what we would call recreational camps or both?
The question is, are these camps going to be geared toward AAU ball, which is the higher-end travel ball, which is higher-end, or just camps in general? Camps in general. So we've been aggregating camps for the last 2 years. And so right now our database is 25,000 plus. And so the one thing that we'll have different that's not currently in the marketplace is the ability to rate camps, right? A lot of kids go to camps to get rated. Well, the parents and the campers, we get to rate the camps. So no two camps are alike, right? And so with the rating, we feel like, think of it as the Angie's List of Yelp for sports camps. Next question. Let's keep it going.
What NCAA schools are you currently connected to right now with your camps?
Obviously, University of Miami, schools, Duke. The co-founders went to Duke, Morehouse, and University of Pittsburgh. But we have relationships with colleges all over the country. So yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Next. Toss. Okay.
Is this gonna be a native app or is this gonna be like browser or
browser based?
Okay, browser.
Initially, and then we'll do native iOS, Android. Yes. Okay. Next. Better.
So you mentioned in your presentation that there's five different levels. Elite. Obviously, I think my kid's elite.
Most parents do, but that's not. Unfortunately, I'm here to tell you that's not always the case.
So I sign him up. What's kind of like the vetting process? What does that look like?
The vetting process would be done by the community, right? Again, just like Angie's List or Yelp. You tell the community if you had a good experience. You tell the community if the camps had hydration, good coaching, nutrition, the field was in good shape, and the community would thank you for it. You know, we just provide the information. We're not dream killers, right? So one of the things that I made sure of that we wasn't going to be dream killers. And so we're not going to tell you if your kid is good or bad. We're going to give you data and information. For us, information is the reduction of risk. The more information you have, the better decisions you can make. Next question.
If you guys are going to be successful with your app, you'll be collecting data on millions of children. That's kind of personal identifying information about their sports and stuff. Are you guys planning on implementing any encryption or protection for that privacy data?
Good question. Eventually, it'll be blockchain-based, but right now we just need to get the data into the system. And sports is different than the financial industry, is different than the medical industry. Kids give us data. You know, they want to be exposed. They want to show exactly what they can do. So we sit in a different situation a little bit. Next question. Yes, you. Nice pass.
Yes.
Who is your primary consumer? Because it seems like it has a strong consumer play, but you said you built in the SaaS model.
This caused a lot of confusion and argument with an internal team. One segment said camps, another segment said the consumer. I'm not going to tell you which side I'm on, but we look at it as a two-sided marketplace, and we're going to lean toward consumers because consumers want the information. We have data on the camps already, so we can market directly to them. But for us to scale, we need to get the consumers on the platform. Next question. Keep it going. Oh, man, y'all easy. Yes, in the green Clarkson.
Handoff.
And Gores. I don't know what that is, but okay. Good. I'm going to repeat the question, so please not kill anybody in attendance. I'm going to repeat the question.
Okay, do you provide, is it a scouting service or anything? Are you from?
You're getting way ahead of yourself. We're dealing with camps. The big vision is to have a connection of the sports ecosystem. So now we start with camps, then we do tournaments, we'll do trainers, we'll do coaches, so on and so forth until we have the whole ecosystem qualified and quantified. But we start with camps, and we're going to go as deep as we can with camps. Next question. Yes. I'm going to repeat the question, everybody, so we don't have to wait for the ball. We got
how much are you raising so that you can get your acquisition costs down on all your consumers?
You're getting all of my business.
Come on, man. What are you offering?
So our customer acquisition cost is probably between $150 and $2. So our raise, we got a convertible note that's about $500, but our raise is going to be $2.5 million. So before I go, anybody who's a tech person, the one limit that we have on our team is on the technical side. So if you want to work with a good team, a bunch of smart guys, and you technical, come see me afterwards. Thanks.
Thank you. Please be gentle with throwing so that we do not spill beers. Thank you, Amanda. Amanda took a party foul on behalf of the team. All right, so everybody has or should have raffle tickets. I have a couple of things to give away tonight. I have a swag bag from Coke that has, it looks like a water bottle, and it looks like a notebook, and it looks like some t-shirts in here. So where is my, I don't have the bucket. Hang on. It's like the actual bucket did not make it up with me. Hang tight. Where's the fishbowl? Technical difficulties. Thank you. Okay. We're going to get back to this. Sorry. Listen, this replaces me throwing swag at your head, and nobody wants that. Okay. Raffle. We're gonna do that a little bit more. Okay. 823-278. Anyone? Must be present to win. Okay, give me another one. Yes. You know I'm gonna make you prove it now, right? Like. Okay, all right. He is an actual winner. Here you go, sir. Thank you for tonight. All right, we're in good shape now. Okay. Are we ready for our very next presenter? We have a warm round of applause for Agenity. We're going to do this again. Can we have a warm round of applause for Agenity?
All right, Atlanta. Good evening. My name is Chris Code. I am Vice President of Customer Development at Agenity. And yes, I am going to put some code on the screen so you can insert your technical joke now about my last name. But let me tell you a little bit about Agenity and what we're all about. We're an analytics software company, and we help enterprises discover and assess, manage and share, and operationalize and consume their analytics as assets. The number one thing that we believe is that you don't only need to manage your data, but you also need to manage your analytics, make them reusable, and operationalize them quickly. So when we say discover and assess, you want to be able to find those analytics because they're powering your company. You want to be able to manage and share them not only within your team, but within other teams so that they can operationalize and consume them and you can see the business results at the end of the day. So today, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about our newest product called Agenity Team. Do I have any SQL developers in the house that work on SQL teams? All right, we got a few. So we're gonna jump into the product and show you what we're up to. All right, you guys have all seen a login screen, so when this comes up, the first thing that you're going to see, that you're going to go in and do, is that you would actually connect to your database. For anybody that's connected to a database before, they know that they enter in their username, their host name, their passwords in order to get connected directly to that. We connect to a lot of the analytical databases that are out in the marketplace today, including things like Netezza, Postgres, Redshift. And after you actually connect to that, you're going to see all of your databases here on the left. So those are of you that are definitely familiar with tools like this. This is a typical database browser object area where you can see all the different table names and column names and schemas that you can connect to. Directly here in this area, this is where you actually write the code. So I've already written some code here. If we go ahead and run this against my Redshift instance, the immediate thing that you're going to see is that we actually support parameters. The reason that you see a lot of the parameter names being the same here is because I run this across my development, my test, and my production environment. And as we know, coders are lazy, and sometimes we put QTY in as the quantity, and I need to be able to change that. But then when you actually run that code, you'll get the results down here in the result area. So one of the things that I wanted to show you directly in here, and what makes this so different than a lot of the other code in analytic environments, is that you can actually share and reuse this code amongst your team members or even yourself personally. One of the things that SQL developers often do is they'll save it into a SQL file, off onto a shared drive or to their desktop, and they can't find it easily. So you want to be able to break your SQL apart or save the whole query. In this case, one of the most common ways of thinking about that is having it on the transaction type. If you think about different transaction types, if you're running a POS data, it might be credit card data, cash data, that often changes where I need to actually edit that. So what I can do is I can actually save this transaction type, this SQL, as a snippet directly in my catalog. I can give it a name, a description, and then save it within whatever directory I want, my own personal directory or my team catalog. All of this becomes searchable metadata that you can then find and then reuse that analytic very quickly. Since I've already done this, I'm just going to kind of show you how this actually works. Down here, we see that same query up at the top. And over on the left, I've switched from looking at my database explorer into my catalog, where I have different team catalog and different users that are directly here. I named that transaction types for that particular where clause. In order for me to use that in my query, I no longer have to write that code again. I can either double click or write this syntax, and all of our products going to understand the underlying code that goes behind that. So we've essentially made SQL an object-oriented programming language. And why is that so important? The reason that is important is because as I change transaction types, I don't have to go find everywhere I've used that piece of code or coded it in as transaction types across multiple other queries. I can go directly into here, I can change it, make the edit, and when I make the update, anywhere else that transaction type is actually being used in other SQL queries by anybody else, it's automatically going to inherit what I've changed directly there. The other cool part is I can actually make each of these folders shareable to my team member. So if I wanted to share this with other people on my team, this is the way I do it. I can right click and then allow them to share. And there's different sharing options that we have. You can have edit, view, or co-owner access. So why am I here tonight and what am I asking for? We're looking for teams of 5 to 20 to join our Agility Team Early Access Program directly with us. So if you work on a SQL team and you want to give this product a try, come find me after. Thank you.
Where did the catch mic go?
Yeah, where's
it
at?
All right. There's some people behind you.
Right,
if you want to gently toss it. Thank you. Okay.
Me. How do we make money? Yes, so our Agility Team product is a seat license product. It's $89 per month for each developers for our Agility Team product. We also have a personal product called Agility Pro if you wanted to actually try this out for free on a personal usage. So it is a freemium model. Next.
Hello, Kayla Thomas. I'm a junior developer, just graduated last week.
Awesome.
This is really, thank you. Thank you. I cried so much. It was so much studying, but I did it. So this is really, really interesting to me. I have two questions. One, is this specifically just an editor for SQL? Is it, or can it be used for other things? Because I see the typical linting stuff. I see the color coding. I see the different line numbers to the left. And my other question does this come with a visualization tool like DB Visualizer, where you're able to see like the actual schema out broken into webs or anything like that?
Sure. So this is a SQL query editor only for a SQL IDE. And we have decided at this point that visualization is not something that we're focused on, because a lot of our customers are data engineers and they're using other tools that visualize the data, such as Tableau or other things. So we might actually drop some small visualizations directly in the tool to help you profile the data, but we actually are staying out of that space and focus specifically on making SQL, because it really all starts with SQL at the end of the day in analytics still.
You're not wrong. Thank you.
Hello, really like the code. Code is great, especially different colors. So my question is, a lot of us come from various different companies that use various different tools. How would we integrate this with our existing tools and existing databases?
Sure, yeah. So if you connect directly to a database today, you use your username and password in order to connect to that database in order to be able to use it. If you wanted to launch a Genity team, we launch it behind your firewall in your environment. All the data stays behind your firewall and it's all yours, safe and secure, and then all of your coders can directly go in and use this. If you launch the Genity team version, obviously that creates a lot of production, productivity and efficiency for your team, because you can come in and you can discover it and find it. Like our new friend that just became a new developer, she could come in and actually search for anything that's been created before so that she could pick it up and start using it directly as well. What other tough ones are out there?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Where are you in the business as far as customers, revenue, and who's the team behind it?
Yeah, sure. So our team is, our CEO is Paul Schout and Dan Kuhn, and Paul's done about six different startups in and of himself. So he's joined us from number seven. From an early access program, we launched the Genity team 2 months ago. We've got two clients that have it installed and are currently using it and giving us direct product feedback on it in order to kind of take it to the next level. And from a revenue perspective, we haven't actually received revenue directly for our Genity team, except on like an actual small scale, a very small scale. So early on in the process for revenue for this product.
Got it.
He's ready. Let's do this.
Go deep.
I know. I feel like people don't want to ask questions that they don't want that gets thrown at them. There's one back there.
Thank you. Hi, junior developer again. Are you looking for any junior developers on your team? Valid question. Post-graduation stress. That would be great.
Very good question. Come and find me afterwards, and we'll get you connected. We'll get you connected to the right folks.
Cool. Thank you. All right.
Hey, so if a company comes in with a bunch of code, is there a way for you guys to easily see a lot of the same code being used in multiple places and suggest, like a save block? And then also, if you want to export it and, you know, leave, you know, you guys, how difficult is it to do that too?
Sure, yeah. So I'll answer the first question first, because a lot of times people don't know what they have, what's been overlapped, and what that actually looks like. So our team actually would come in and offer that as a potential service for you to say, like, hey, here's where you have some overlapping code, and here's where your productivity and your efficiencies can be. And we've done that by building our own analytics internally to understand exactly what that looks like to launch it out. And then what was your second question was?
So, like, if you built a lot of these save things and you end up wanting to leave, how difficult is it to like export?
Sure, you're going to be able to actually save everything that you put directly in your catalog as your own kind of SQL file if you want to, in order to export it out and then be able to do that. And then also we're looking at ways to be able to import and use what you already have built up, so you can easily onboard and get started very, very quickly.
Cool, thanks.
Thank you very much. Nicely done, guys. All right, we're going to do some different swag this time. It's actually the shirt that I'm wearing. Just for funsies. This is a good shirt. I approve of this shirt. So let's start with this one. ATV shirt is 823-189. Anyone?
Going once, going twice. Okay. Eight, two, three, 189. Yeah. False alarm. All right. Oh, he's got one. All right. You got to yell it out. Congratulations. Yes, I do. Sometimes I'm going to have to prove this. Okay, we're going to do one more piece of swag on this round. I have a pair of Atlanta Tech Village socks. These are lovely. Ladies, these work great under boots. These are very nice. Okay. Hilton, we're gonna figure out the music so we get more peppy up here. That's not you, that's me. 823-180. Anyone? Oh, yeah. Thank you very much. Okay, that went more smoothly this time. We are on to our third presenter. Are we good? All right. Round of applause for Momi.
Hi. First, I want to thank the volunteers, the Atlanta Tech Village, Startup Village, and all the sponsors tonight. Thank you so much. So my name is Bryce, and I'm one of the co-founders of Momi. Our mission is fantastic lawns. So I moved to Atlanta about 2 years ago with my wife, and we absolutely love Atlanta. Atlanta, come on. However, I don't know how many of you cut your grass in the middle of the summer, but it sucks. So my wife and I were looking for someone to do that, a lawn service provider, and we couldn't find anybody. We couldn't find any reviews, any ratings, and we couldn't find anybody reliable. And we also wanted to pay online, which was kind of a problem when we started looking into this. And as we started looking into this problem and talking to customers and doing customer reviews, we found that they were having almost the same problem. So they couldn't find reputable vendors, they couldn't find reviews or price matching, and they also couldn't pay online. Most of the service providers today want check or cash, and that's just because they don't have any way of accepting it. They haven't used Square or any of those other tools. So then I was talking to a friend of mine, Jason, who had recently purchased a lawn service company in addition to his regular job, and I was telling him my problems, and he said, well, I've got the other side of that problem. I'm having trouble finding customers, retaining customers. I don't know how to process payments online, and it's really hard for me to manage my customers, optimize my routing, and all that stuff. So we got together and we said, well, that sounds like a business, but what does the market look like? So we looked at the market, and it's about a $95 billion market with 4.6 year-over-year growth. About a third of that market is just basic lawn service, so that's cutting your lawn, edging, that kind of stuff, and then the other two-thirds are one-time services, landscaping, etc. There's over 500,000 individual lawn care businesses. Each generate, on average, about $200,000 in ARR. So we said, hey, that seems like a perfect business for us to start. So that's why we built Momi. This is a web-based application as well as mobile. It serves both the customers and the service providers. So I think the question is, how do you make money? So we charge a 3% processing fee per transaction. Most customers on average pay about $135 a month. 3% of that is about $4. If we can attain 1% of the market, that's a $27 million ARR business for Momi. So let's jump into a quick demo. So I'm going to first start with a customer side demo. So the only thing I've done is registered this customer. And the first thing I get is, hey, here are some things you need to do. Oh, sorry, still presenting. Sorry, switching now. Cool. So the first thing that I'm asked to do is these three to-do items. So I'm going to add a service location, and I'm going to use the zoom in. How's that? And let's call this ATL and be our home, and I'm going to use the Tech Village address here. What is that, Piedmont? There we go. And it's a half acre, something like that. So now we have a service location added, and now I want to add services. So I go here, and I click Add Services, and the first thing I want to do is add lawn maintenance. So I describe a little bit about my lawn. Maybe I want the front and back. I want it every other week, and got a few other questions, and then I accept the overgrown lawn policy, and then I can find service providers. So these are sample made-up service providers for this area and for this demo. You'll get rating and price for that service provider. So I think we'll go with LexCorp. and we'll add the service. And so now that service provider will now provide us service, and it will get into their routing and scheduling as part of the application. So I'm gonna switch over to my mobile real quick. All right, and so the service provider side of things, and again, everything on the mobile I'm showing you, you can do on the web and vice versa. So I'm logging as the service provider, and I'm gonna get some quick stats about my business. So how many lawns do I have remaining this week, revenue, things like that. And then I get into my appointments list. So these are the appointments that I have this week in order that is gonna optimize my ability to get the number of services in a day. It's got some features where I can click on the icon and go directly to a map, and it'll route automatically to that service location. I can go into the details of the appointment, and I can start the service. On the back end, we're aggregating that data so I can see how long on average it takes, and then I can complete the service, and now I'm on to my next service appointment. I can also right from here skip my appointment and then reschedule it just in case I need to do it later. Additionally, customer management, so I can go in here and I can call directly the customer, or I can dig into the details of what lawn maintenance package they have or any services. All right, questions?
Hey, love the UI.
Thanks.
Looks beautiful. A couple questions. One, there's a few lawn companies out there, Lawn Love, others. How do you think about your value prop or who wins and why? And then second, you know, for daycare, for dog walkers, there's always that issue of folks starting to pay each other under the table off platform. How do you think about customer loss like that?
So the first question was around how do we compare or the competitive landscape. So the main two competitors that we think of in our space are Lawn Starter and Plows and Mows. Those two companies are specifically focused around the customer side. They do have a vendor side, but when it comes to revenue, if we start on the service provider side and then offer them payments, which they can't do today, it's easy conversion, very low cost of acquisition. And then second question was around how do they not pay under the table? One of the reasons that they wouldn't do that is because once they've logged in and set up service, it's just gonna go and reoccur, and they're not really saving a huge amount by doing that, and it adds a lot of overhead for the service provider. So when you think about it, hey, I have to get a check or cash to this service provider, but they come on a Tuesday at 11 a.m. It's very challenging to be home at that time and be able to pay them. So for us, it's a convenience, and it's a very low cost.
Cool, I have a question for you.
Sure.
So I noticed in the tech demo that you accepted the overgrown lawn policy. Can you explain more about that and how come you implemented such a policy?
Sure. So imagine a situation where it's the middle of summer, you get a service provider and you haven't had lawn service for 2 months. Well, the lawn service provider is going to get there and it's going to take them two or three times as long to cut that lawn. So the policy basically says for the first service, they can charge up to 100% extra in order to cover their additional costs because the lawn was basically very long and took extra time that first cut.
Hey, I have two questions. First question is, I see that you have a lot of addresses for the appointments. Is there any thoughts on optimizing the route for all the appointments so they know the minimal time to go to each one?
So I apologize, that's exactly what we're doing. So we actually do in order, they are optimized exactly in the order that will minimize the amount of travel for a service provider.
Perfect. Okay. Also, what are you looking for?
You mean in the context of funding? So we're looking for $1.45 million for funding, which would cover technology and sales, focusing on the top five largest cities in the Southeast. About 44% of the market is based just in the Southeast. So we live here, and the top five cities, especially with a big suburban population, would represent a really attainable and large growth opportunity.
Well, I think one of the things, this is my question, I mean, I think you're missing probably your biggest competitor, which is HomeAdvisor. I mean, those other companies are okay, but HomeAdvisor is the gorilla in the room. And the other thing is when you're talking about your recurring revenue, I've dealt with many, and I've owned several landscaping companies and invested in a lot of them. I'm telling you, you might need to think about how, that recurring revenue there, because most of them are just trying to save a dollar. So I'm just saying, what do you think about that?
Sure, that's a great question and a great feedback. So I'll take it in reverse order. So on the service provider side, the fee is going directly to the customer. So regardless of which vendor they pick on our platform, the fee is going to be on the customer side. So the service provider doesn't take any cost to their revenue. And the first part about HomeAdvisor, same thing with Yelp. I would use that as another example, is a lot of their stuff is really around reviews and finding service, but these are vendors that generally have 100 or less customers, and so they don't generally get reviewed and rated. When we looked on Yelp in our area, it was very challenging to find any service providers that had been rated with more than one review, and generally those kinds of sites, when you go on there to rate them, it's not usually because you have a lot of positive things to say, at least that's been my experience. It's usually you're sort of upset with the lawn service or something like that. But we can talk after. I'd be happy to follow up.
Hey, I don't know if you said this already, but if you did, I'm sorry. Is it live? And if so, how many users do you have?
So it is live. We are alpha testing with two service providers right now and a couple of customers. So we wanted to get some feedback in the field and see how they used it day to day. We really just got into that about 2 or 3 weeks ago.
Thank you very much. He will be up here for questions after. I saw a lot of hands in the back. Don't worry. Our presenters do stay up to chat afterwards. All right. I have another fantastic Coke handout. And again, we've got a lot going on in here. There's a shirt. We're going to unpack it now. Notebook. And an extremely heavy bottle. So I feel like that thermos is going to keep your coffee really warm, or I guess you could have cold coffee too. Your other coffee really cold. Okay. Raffling. It is 823-204. 204. Anyone? Anyone? I started moving really fast last time and people started standing up, but I'm going to keep going. All right. 823-272. Anyone? I know y'all are here. Either that or you're too many beers in. 823-346. Yes, winner! Woo! Okay. We're on our fourth presenter. And again, don't forget, we're going to raffle those 311 tickets at the end of the night. Don't disappear. I have more swag. Okay. Has everybody gotten their beer update? I saw a lot of people going for beer. Great. Okay. Round of applause for our fourth presenters of the night, About You Family Medicine. Welcome to the stage.
All right. Well, hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Sanders. I'm a board-certified family medicine physician, and this is Allie Shul. She's the Jill of all trades in our medical office, and we're here to tell you about our startup. It's called About You Family Medicine, and what we offer is healthcare that reimagines the patient-doctor relationship.
Our clinic model is called direct primary care. We work directly with our patients rather than the insurance companies. By cutting out the insurance, the middleman, we reduce cost, improve access, and really focus on quality. Our goal is to bring the free market back into healthcare, where cost, quality, and reputation earn your business. We're offering innovative healthcare with today's technology. Take a look at our video.
Sooner or later, we all get sick. But not everyone who gets sick seeks advice from a physician. Why? It's because going to see your doctor is almost always expensive and inconvenient. But it doesn't have to be. Have you heard about direct primary care? DPC is a new model for delivering primary health care, and its simplicity is its genius. As a member of a DPC practice, you pay a low monthly membership fee, averaging around $50 to $70 a month. That membership gives you an all-access pass to your doctor through office visits, phone calls, text messaging, email, and even virtual office visits. We're happy to see you in person, but we get it. It's the 21st century. So we give you the tools to reach us from your home, your car, the office, the store, or even out on the beach during your relaxing vacation. The goal of DPC is to make it easy and affordable to get the help you need whenever and wherever you need it. Your DPC doctor can refer you to specialists, like say a dermatologist specializing in jellyfish toxicology, and will help you navigate through the other parts of the healthcare system should the need arise. It's traditional care with today's technologies. DPC isn't a replacement for insurance that covers catastrophic events. So you might be thinking, I already have insurance. Why do I need DPC? Even with insurance, the out-of-pocket costs of healthcare add up fast. A visit to urgent care, lab tests, or a trip to the ER could each cost more than your entire annual DPC membership. And if you have a high deductible insurance plan, you can easily burn through your deductible before your insurance even kicks in. But a lot of those costs can be avoided if you have regular access to a doctor who can take care of up to 80 to 90% of all your healthcare needs. More importantly, doctors join a DPC practice so they can have personal relationships with their patients and give them quality care without the added costs and bureaucracy of insurance companies. But don't take our word for it. Tens of thousands of people across the country are already members of a DPC practice, and they absolutely love it. In fact, DPC is actually something that both Democrats and Republicans endorse, and they don't agree on almost anything. If you want to live a long, healthy life and want convenient 24/7 healthcare from a doctor who is dedicated to both keeping you healthy and minimizing your out-of-pocket expenses, all for less than the cost of your monthly cell phone bill, then your best shot is to become a member of a direct primary care practice. We all get sick. Don't let cost and inconvenience get between you and your health. Find a DPC practice near you and discover what many are calling the best, most affordable healthcare they've ever had.
All right, so we just want to open it up to any questions at this point and see if we can help people understand how we're revolutionizing healthcare in a way at this point.
Hey, how's it going? So do you guys know how much the average person spends per year on this kind of stuff?
In terms of our membership or healthcare in general, or?
Yeah, like how much the average person spends on like an urgent care or something like that per year?
So I would say around Atlanta, an urgent care fee is at least $150 cash just coming in the door. And then on top of that, one of the worst parts is they do labs, they do imaging, all these ancillary services that folks get a bill in the mail 4 to 6 weeks later, and who knows what that adds up to. So everything through our office is transparent. People know exactly what they're paying, and we deliver the services only after they understand what the cost is.
And your service is $50 to $70 a month, right?
Yeah. So we are $75 per month per adult, and then any child in the family is half price. And we also work with a lot of employers around Atlanta and offer a lower rate for them as well.
Okay, thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. So subscription businesses basically bank on the user having faith that they're going to recoup that value. Apart from such an ER visit, which they might not foresee, what, I guess, percentage of the market would you say is foreseeably, consistently spending already $800 or more per year?
I mean, it's a good question. It can add up really quickly between, honestly, just one visit to see your primary care clinician and thinking all of your care is going to be covered. I think one of the real frustrations in the current healthcare industry is that bill that comes 6 weeks later, and it could be $400 or $600. Maybe your insurance says, okay, we paid half of it for you, and you're still stuck with a $300 bill. And that was a service that you didn't even understand what the cost was. What we try to help folks with is lower their insurance premium, use their insurance for things that they really can't predict, those catastrophic events that are high dollar items, and then pay for your healthcare out of pocket, because your healthcare is actually really affordable. It's that middleman that makes it look so expensive.
We also have some value adds for our patients. So we have a pharmacy in the office. We carry a lot of basic maintenance medications, and we do this at wholesale. So literally what the pharmacy is giving them to us for, we give to the patient. So for instance, Zyrtec, $1.30 for a month's supply. High blood pressure medications, diabetic medications, albuterol inhalers. Things that people are paying a lot of money for at the pharmacy, we're getting wholesale in addition to labs. So we've contracted directly with lab companies. We're able to do hemoglobin A1Cs for $4, complete metabolic panels, $3. So we add value through these other services as well.
Oh, there we go. So for clarity, we're not paying a copay, but it's not necessarily covering emergency situations. So what specifically, like I'm seeing, you know, you gave the example of somebody having a cold, but up to what point is considered emergency? Like clearly a gunshot wound is an emergency, sure. Obviously, but at what point do you stop covering?
Yeah, and so, you know, what I would encourage people to think about this as is your own personal doctor, someone that knows you, that trusts you, that can honestly probably save you so much time and money down the line once you've built that relationship. But on top of that, you have access to your own personal doctor 24/7. And so what a lot of people think is an emergency, like you're having difficulty breathing or you're having anxiety but your chest hurts and you think it could be a heart attack. Those are things that you can now get in touch with someone that you know and trust and avoid that entire Saturday you spend in the emergency room, that $2,000-$3,000 bill that's gonna come in the mail later. And those experiences are invaluable. I mean, we had a family call me on Sunday. They were just all sick and out of town, and in 5 minutes of my time on a Sunday, I was able to call in medications to get them well again and keep them happy on their vacation. And for that family, that makes all the difference. The urgent care for those four folks would have probably been $1,000.
Hi, how are you doing? Okay, just making sure this works here. You know how somebody will sign up for HBO and then they'll burn through Game of Thrones in a month and then they'll quit like a month later, right? How do you prevent that kind of scenario for the healthcare equivalent?
Yeah, and I think this is our last question. So we have a initial upfront 3-month membership join fee, covers their first 3 months of service. We hope by that point people realize the value we can add. And truthfully, we're not trying to lock people into long-term relationships they're not happy with. I would rather have happy customers fill those slots. So it's purely month to month after that, and some people choose to leave, but most don't.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, I am down to an Atlanta Tech Village hat. I see you back there helping with my higher energy. Yes. 823-351. Anyone. We're going fast. All right. Speak up. 823-275. All right, we're going to do one more, and then whoever is going to actually get that excited is going to get the hat. 823-028. All right, I've got a hat. Who wants that? Who is excited about the hat? Okay, Okay, I'm getting, see, now he got, oh, he's got the ticket. Thank you. He doesn't have the ticket. He's just really excited, he says. All right. So after this, we will do the ticket draw for the tickets for the 311 concert. And in the meantime, we have our last but not least presenter for the night. And we have one more round of applause for Lane London.
Thank you all for sticking around tonight. I really appreciate it. My name's London. I am the CEO and co-founder of Lane London. We are a wedding dress retail tech company. Our slogan is, men do it, why shouldn't women? And usually I ask the audience to answer that, but we're on a time crunch. Men rent their tuxedos for their weddings, for, you know, all types of events, but specifically for your wedding, why does the woman have to spend thousands of dollars on a dress that she'll only wear once? So we've set out to solve that. We believe, just like Jennifer Hyman did about 5 or 6 years ago when she started Rent the Runway, that every woman should have access to the Cinderella experience for that special occasion in her life. We think that that goes beyond just, you know, events, that goes on to their wedding also. We established, my partner, my co-founder and I established Lane London in 2018. We've been bringing in revenue since February of this year. And we are a women-led, minority-led retail startup. Our boutique is actually located here in Atlanta, and we have about 150 dresses in our inventory. So there's major gaps and opportunities. A lot of them we already are aware of. You know, what you see, what the average American can't afford, that Instagram perfect wedding. So that dress that Kim Kardashian wore, she most likely didn't pay for that. However, if, you know, a bride sees that and she wants that same dress, she'll most likely be able to get that probably for a low price of 100 grand. Also, you have things like the dress that Carrie wore in Sex and the City. This poor, unfortunate soul found that dress identically in China, and she received it for about $100, and that's what it looked like. So there's areas that, you know, some people try and cut corners, and it doesn't necessarily work in their favor. The average price for a wedding is about $35,000, and the average price for the dress is $1,600. Men are spending anywhere from $50 to $200 on a tuxedo, so there's just that disparity there. The wedding retail industry in the United States is over $3 billion. We're actually one of the only countries that doesn't do wedding dress rental. So if you look at China, Australia, Japan, and even Syria, wedding dress rentals are very common. So who is our girl? It's really three different demographics. We have that stylish student, so someone who recently graduated, who is now engaged. She doesn't necessarily have money to spend on her dream dress, but she wants to wear her dream dress. We have that fiscal and fancy girl who most likely recently just graduated, just got engaged, making a little less than 100 grand. She shops on ThredUp, on Poshmark, on Rent the Runway, but she doesn't also have that money, additional income to be able to spend. And then we have that love later in life. So it's that woman who has prioritized her education, her career, and she's found love later in life. And she doesn't necessarily want to spend thousands on a dress. She may have kids, she may have, you know, other priorities, but she still wants to look great on her big day. So where we are. So as I mentioned, we just started bringing in revenue this February. So we brought in a little over $50,000. That's about 40 couples. How it works, it's really simple. We say find it, reserve it, and return it, or love, wed, and return. So you find a dress, so I'll show you what it looks like on our website, which is also mobile friendly. You reserve it on our website, or you can come to our boutique and look through the dresses and reserve it that way. And then you just return it. So if you're local, you can drop it off with us, or you can send it back in a prepaid shipping label. If you're not sure about renting your dress, because we do understand that is something very new, we have a bridal buyback program. So we partnered with a big designer named Justin Alexander. And if you'd like to purchase a dress from him, you can purchase it through us, bring the dress back when you're done, and you'll get 40 to 50% of your money back. That dress then converts over to our rental inventory for another person to enjoy. So this is what our website looks like mobile. So this is the homepage. So we also do accessories. So that's the veils, the sashes, things of that sort. And then they can browse the accessories, they can browse the Justin Alexander collection, or they can look at all of our rental dresses. We also have a blog, and we give, you know, lots of tips for, you know, brides on a budget, what to do when you have that unruly bridesmaid, things like that. So we're really just trying to put out great content and reach people through that way also. And then obviously RSVPing your dream dress. So how that looks is we're integrated with Calendly. So the bride would simply go on, select the date, select the time, enter a little bit of information about her. That way we have more information before they come into their appointment. So we want to know, you know, when's their wedding date, what's their size, what's their budget, and that really helps us find and select dresses for them. So future state, we're looking at doing pop-ups and mobile shops. So we're going to keep the brick and mortar here in Atlanta, but we are looking to do pop-ups and mobile shops. Questions? Thank you. That's me.
Hello.
Hi.
All right, so I got a question. So yeah. I watch a lot of shows like Bridezillas and Say Yes to the Dress and everything. And I noticed that they create a lot of like Cinderella moments where people fall in love with the dress and they really want to buy it at that time. How do you create that same Cinderella moment at that time for someone that's not going to be actually purchasing the dress?
Absolutely. So we have, as I mentioned, a bridal boutique who, based on our brides, and you can actually Google search us. We have over 60 five-star reviews from brides that have actually come to our boutique. They say they have a better experience at our boutique from everything from the process of booking the consultation to the champagne to their Pandora station. They have a better experience there than any of the bridal boutiques in Atlanta. That's basically the best way to say it. Check our reviews.
Hello.
Hi.
So I saw that someone can get 50% of the value back, yep. Right? So that is a really good margin on your part, so that's great. However, I just want to ask, what was the initial buy cost for the wedding dress?
So anytime you hear the word bridal or wedding, it's usually marked up 4 to 5x. So we have given up a little bit of that margin to be able to offer that to brides. Because as I mentioned, we want all brides, no matter what your socioeconomic status is, to be able to have the dress of their dreams. So we're still making 2 to 3x off of those dresses. And then once they come back into our inventory, that's 100% profit.
So you mentioned your buyback program. Do you have the inverse of that, where a bride rents a dress and she gets really excited and emotional and doesn't want to return it and instead decides to purchase it?
We do, except we charge them 5x.
Whoa.
The goal is for you not to have that dress in your closet. We want other brides to be able to wear that dress.
Okay, first off, great presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah, definitely, I just had to say that. Out of curiosity, so with the on the pop-up stores, that is an interesting aspect, but how much time are you devoting to actually expanding on those pop-up stores?
Yeah, so we've bootstrapped, so we've cashed out our 401ks and life savings to about $250,000. We are looking to scale to Texas as our next area, and to do that, we are really big in the bridal show market. And to be able to do that, we would have to collaborate with local, meaning like Texas, local bridal boutiques and people within the community. That's going to take a lot of money because we want that experience that brides have when they come to our boutique to have that experience on the road.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah.
First of all, congrats on proving product market fit here.
I think this
is great.
Thank you.
My question is, how do you fill the market for that area of people who don't necessarily fit the stock sizing? So
yep.
People who are either smaller than bespoke, I think is something that brides look forward to, being fitted for their gown. So how do you, you know, accommodate that customer?
Yep. So we have an amazing full-time alterations manager who about 90% of our dresses are altered in some way. And it's really about deconstructing and reconstructing instead of actually cutting a dress, which is normally done. Also to answer your question, I think that, first of all, we carry sizes up to 26. Being in the Atlanta market, the average size of a bride is 18. And when they go to a lot of these boutiques, the sample sizes that they have aren't even anywhere close to what they're having. So they're literally like pinning a dress in front of a woman. And you know, when you talk about customer experience, that's not the customer experience that someone wants to have when they have their whole family with them. And they don't want to feel bad that they're plus size.
Question again for you. How do you handle cleaning the dresses and the sanitary addresses at the end of the day.
So we have partnered with a dry cleaner, so we get discounted dry cleaning rates. And then also mentioned we have an in-house alterations seamstress woman who also does cleanings. Every dress is inspected and cleaned before they get it.
I was curious, do you, you said that you receive from a designer, but do you take dresses from other people, like, you know?
Yeah, unfortunately we don't. We tried that when we first started to fulfill our inventory, you know, going on Facebook Marketplace and stuff. But we just found that, like I mentioned, dresses have already been cut. Once a dress is cut, it's very difficult to reuse that dress. Our dresses have about 15 to 20 uses, so that tells you a lot about what the bridal industry is educating women, that this is like this holy, you know, one-time use thing. That's not the case at all. So unfortunately, we don't do that. It's kind of too little too late for brides. We're trying to be nice about that, but we're trying to, you know, yeah. So.
Thank you very much. Fantastic end. All right, can I get my Coca-Cola representative up here to draw for these 311 tickets? Perfect. Hilton for the win.
All right, here we go. It's going to be a good show. All right, here we go. 8, 2, 3, 2, 9, 2. 8, 2, 3, 2, 9, 2.
Oh, redraw, okay.
All right. 8, 2, 3, 1, 8, 5.
No, no, this guy, man.
Man,
this is, I know, man. I guess I'll go, you wanna go? We should go.
All right, 8, 2, 3, 2, 0, 3. Yeah! There we go.
All right, thank you guys for coming out tonight and for suffering through some of the technical difficulties with the toss mic. We appreciate you all. We are the last Monday of the month, and you can catch us online under hashtag ATLSV. Thank you all.
It was nice meeting you.
Great meeting you, too.
Stay in touch.